councils and others listening to the debate. Can I also ask members to ensure that any mobile devices are switched to silent and do not cause a distraction during the meeting? And I would remind everyone that the use of mobile devices for the taking or making of phone calls is not permitted in the chamber. I would like to inform members that this meeting is being filmed by both members of the public and also by the council. The council are broadcasting the stream of the meeting live on YouTube. And can I please remind members that they are required to stand when addressing the council meeting. We're not expecting a fire alarm tonight, but if one should occur, please follow the officers down the stairs out of the front of the town hall to the assembly point. Can we move on to item one on the agenda? Minutes of the meeting of the council held on the 10th of July 2019. I will move those minutes. Mr Deputy Mayor, will you second those minutes?
I second those minutes, Madam Mayor.
All those in favour, please say aye.
Aye.
Item two on the agenda, declarations of interest. Have we any declarations of interest? Item three on the agenda, Mayor's communications. During 2012, the Council signed an Armed Forces Covenant. The Ministry of Defence, in collaboration with the Royal British Legion, have updated the Covenant to better reflect the challenges currently faced by the Armed Forces community and to highlight key areas where local authorities and other partners can provide support. I therefore invite Councillor Cosima Townley, the Council's Armed Forces Champion, to re-sign the Covenant on behalf of the Council. I'm delighted to welcome Lieutenant Colonel Jim Dowell from Headquarters Northwest, who will sign the Covenant on behalf of the Armed Forces. It's a great honour also to welcome Wing Commander Chris Ashworth, Regional Employer Engagement Director for the Reserve Forces and Cadets Association, who will present Councillor Townley with the Bronze Award under the Defence Employer Recognition Scheme for the Council's work to support ex-service men and women.
I think we're moving on to the award, which the council and council employees have very much deserved, but I will leave Wing Commander Ashworth to explain that.
I'll answer to anything, don't worry. Madam Mayor, councillors, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It gives me very, very great pleasure. I'm very privileged and proud this evening to present, on behalf of Her Majesty's Armed Forces and the Ministry of Defence, your Bronze Employer Recognition Scheme Award. This is for the outstanding support that the Council gives the Armed Forces community and the members of the Armed Forces community whom it employs in its workforce. And it's very much what we hope the start of a journey towards a silver award next year and perhaps a gold award the year after that. So, as I say, it is with very great pleasure and privilege that I present this on behalf of Her Majesty's Armed Forces and the Ministry of Defence. Thank you so much for everything you do for the Armed Forces community. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. You may want to sit down. Thank you.
Item number four on the agenda, public questions. Requests to speak have been received from Mr. Mubashir Lone and Mr. Mazakar Ali. Mr. Lone, would you come forward first, please, and you have 3 minutes to address the council.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. My name is Mubashir Lone, and I am British Kashmiri serving in Burnley since last 28 years. Honourable Mayor, councillors, and people available, present in this gallery, I know I've been having some problem to be speak because I had a stroke, and with the stroke, sometime I get some problem. But this problem is actually for the Kashmir, for those people who've been having this problem since last 72 years. So if I not speak up for them, it won't be a fair that just for the small problem that I'm not speaking up. Madam Mayor, Kashmir is a place in subcontinent. There's a two nation division happens there, Kashmir was an independent state. Muslim got the Pakistan and Hindus got the India. The Kashmiris got the right to be either go to Pakistan or to India. But because the population of Kashmir was mostly the Muslims, they were willing to go to the Pakistan, whereas the ruler was a Hindu, he wants to go to India. This division caused a problem, and then they broke up a fight. With this fight, there is some tribes from the Pakistan, they helped the Kashmiris to be get some land free from the that Maharaja of that time. India took this problem to the UNO, and UNO have decided that they will have the plebiscite, and the Kashmiri decide their own future, either if they want to go to Pakistan or India. But it's never happened since last 72 years. When United Nations put the ceasefire, because of the ceasefire, the both side armies take control of the ceasefire, which become a control line of control. The families who are living peacefully in the Kashmir before, they've been divided because of this control line. If mother is on Indian side, the son is on Kashmir, Pakistan side. And it's been happening since last 7 decades. They are not able to see each other. Because of that courage, they've been trying to resolve this issue. They've been fighting for that. In 1980s, they have started strongly to be finish this siege, and they want to come down and they want to meet their families. At that time, the India have actually used the excessive force and then used the Indian Army Act and start using the pellet gun rapes and everything to stop these things. This has happened in past, and when the
30 seconds left.
Some of this one, they have done that the revocation of 370 and 35A, which is causing a lot of disturbance in the area. Lockdown, there is no internet, no connection of anything. Even yesterday there was an earthquake, and we don't know what our families are doing in that area. We don't know anything about that. We don't know our loved ones are alive or not. We want this forum to be get past this resolution so we can do a political work for those people so they become like humans like us.
Okay. I'll have
thank
to
you.
Stop you there.
Cheers. Thank you.
Well done. Thank you, Mr. Lone. Mr. Ali, would you like to come forward now? And you will have 3 minutes to address the council.
Madam Mayor, councillors, ladies and gentlemen, good evening. I stand to speak on the motion that you'll be debating shortly and hopefully you will unanimously support. I recall setting up the working committee on Kashmir on this council some 22 years ago. Didn't believe at the time that I'll be coming back here 22 years later, still talking about it, campaigning for it. Well, as you know, Madam Mayor and councillors, we have thousands of residents in Burnley and Pendle, and in fact millions in this country who have roots in that part of the world. And recent revocation of Article 370 and Article 35 of the Constitution of the Indian Government, the more these fascist government has taken over the rights of the Kashmiris who in the past, as Mr. Lawan previously mentioned, the part of that country acceded to India with an agreement of having some rights to have their flag, have their government, have their assembly and prime minister. Now, with the recent revocation of those articles, India, with the stroke, have taken off those rights from the Kashmiris. And in addition, they have imposed a total lockdown in that area and curfew. Now, as you know, with the lockdown, the Indian government has also increased the military presence there. You also know that that part of the country is the world's most militarized region in the world. So on top of that, they increased the military presence there. And the recent statistic shows that each household has 1.5 soldier outside the house. Just imagine yourselves with your family and with your loved ones in the household, you're imprisoned in your own house, and you make a slight mistake and go outside during the curfew hours, you can be shot. And that's the reality that Kashmiris in India are facing at this moment. Now, Mr. Lawan mentioned about the history. It is a British legacy, because it is the British who sold that part of the country to a prince whose descendants later acceded to India.
30 seconds now, left.
We, Madam Mayor and councillors, have a moral duty to assist to find a resolution in that part of the world. With those words, I commend the motions to you.
Thank you, Mr. Ali. Councillor Briggs, would you like to respond to the speakers?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Mr. Lawan, Mr. Ali, I would like to thank you for addressing this council on this important issue. I'm sure that all the councillors have listened carefully to what has been said. The violence and instability in the region concerns us all. I'm aware that a number of residents in the borough are of Kashmiri descent, and a lot of them have strong ties within the region. I was extremely concerned when the Indian government issued a presidential order to abolish Kashmir's special status last month. Analysts have warned about the abolishing the special status for Kashmir would ignite unrest, and it has clearly has. It has also escalated tensions in neighbouring Pakistan, which is not good news for stability in the region. You will be aware that a motion is on tonight's agenda to discuss this important issue. Like me, I am confident that all the councillors will want to see an immediate end to the violence and will welcome efforts that reduce tension in the region. And I wish peace and prosperity to all the people in Kashmir. God bless.
Thank you, Councillor Briggs. As Mr. Ali said, our next agenda item deals with the issues raised by the speakers. So rather than members addressing the issue now, I'd suggest that it's done as part of that item. So we'll move on to item 5 on the agenda, motions to council. Item 5A, Kashmir. Can I point out to members that once the motion has been moved and seconded, members may speak once and for a maximum of 5 minutes. Members may only then speak again on an amendment. Councillor Arif Khan, will you please move the motion regarding Kashmir as set out on the agenda?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Before I move the motion, I would like to say a few words here. First of all, I'm grateful to my two speakers here. They enlightened our chamber, and I want to add further information for the information of all the councillors and then the public in the gallery here. A brief history of Kashmir. Kashmir is a princely state, and the history goes back to 5,000 years here. and the freedom struggle is not 72 years, it's going on for 200 years since the British government sold Kashmir for 75 lakh rupees. Today is about 37,000 pounds, yeah. And in bracket, I would say, each Kashmiri sold for 3 rupees. If today you work out today, it's 0.0001 penny. So that was the value of Kashmiris. They were sold like slaves. Yeah. Kashmir is a vast country. It's bigger than United Kingdom all together. I think over 220,000 kilometers and remote places. Yeah. And the population there in the valley, actually the Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir is a big Ladakh, some occupied by China, some in Pakistan, Gilgit-Baltistan, Azad Kashmir. So it's a collective, you know, there's a big country. But in the valley, which is called Kashmir, over 1 million people are prisoners in their own homes. Yes. Since the revocation of Article 370 and 35A, the autonomy of Kashmiris is gone now. My descendants are Kashmiris. I have got the certificate that proves that I can live there and buy land and everything. That was our fundamental rights here, not anymore here. Now, before the partition here, there were, according to historians, about 650 princely states were in the old Indo-Pakistan, in the Indian subcontinent here. Some, all the Muslim populated areas given the choice to join Pakistan, and the Hindus and the Sikhs, if they want to join with the India. So that's how they divided. And the British left on 1947. Some majority of the smaller states joined with India and Pakistan. Only Hyderabad, Dakhan, and Kashmir. Actually, Hyderabad, they declared independence. They stayed for 14 months as an independent state here. But eventually, India sent their troops and grabbed that state here. Exactly the same what's happening in Kashmir here. Soon after 1947, what British did, Lord Mountbatten, the last viceroy of India here, he gave the opportunity to Kashmir because whichever they want to go. Kashmir is a populated Muslim population. 80% of them were Muslims there here. And the Maharaja Hari Singh, he was Hindu Maharaja, so he joined with the India, and then uprising starts here. So it's going on for 200 years here. And after Second World War, that's how it's, you know, the partition happens, and then they moved on here. And between India and Pakistan, there were 3 wars fought for Kashmir. And those were conventional wars, yeah. And I dread to think what's going to happen if war breaks out again, because both are nuclear powers, yeah. And Kashmiri peoples are looking towards international community. Because of curfew and because of persecution of individuals, I invite you to check the YouTube Kashmir news, and you know there, and you will find a very distressing videos there. Yeah, people leave their homes, go to the shops, and you never see them again. Yeah, the rape took place, and the young people were blinded with pellets. Yeah, and 900,000 Indian army is there, and that works out about 9-10 people to one army person. Just imagine, we are here maybe 60 or 70 of us here, so maybe 8 or 9 army personnel are there for us here.
30 seconds.
Yeah. I conclude on this note here. My prayers and duas are with Kashmiri people. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ease their pains and sufferings. Yeah. All we can do is pray. And I urge this chamber to please support the humanity. Thank you.
Councillor Sue Graham, will you second the motion?
Yes, thank you, Madam Mayor. I'll second that motion. In doing so, I'd just like to say just a few words. I will not speak about the heritage of Kashmir because I'm not an expert. It's not, and I wouldn't like to appropriate that history. I speak really as a mother and a grandmother because there are people in this borough with parents and grandparents out in Kashmir, with aunties and uncles out there, and they've not been able to get in touch with them for several weeks now, since the 5th of August. And my daughter rings me three times a day to make sure I haven't fallen down or locked myself out or anything like that. So I hate to think what it must be like if you cannot get in touch in any way with your family out in Kashmir. Meanwhile, this government is looking on at yet another example of ethnic cleansing in that area. There are human rights violations going on as we speak. They are serious enough for the United Nations to call for a commission of inquiry into the issues out there. And this is very deeply concerning for the people who are in the gallery here, for the families of Kashmiri descent who are resident in Burnley and in the Northwest. I believe we should show solidarity with these people, and I'm going to second with great pleasure Councillor Arif Khan's motion, and I'm going to call for a named vote too, please. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Please can you stand if you would like to have a named vote? When we get to it, that's sufficient, thank you. There will be a named vote. Any member? Councillor Pate.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm obviously no expert on Kashmir, but what I will say is that the balcony is full tonight of residents of Burnley who are obviously directly affected. We should not have this going on in this day and age. We cannot stand by whilst our fellow human beings are persecuted, no matter where in the world this is. You will remember that at a previous council I did mention some of the sites that I saw in Srebrenica, and already experts that study this are saying that there are comparisons along the 10 steps of genocide. We cannot allow it to progress any further, and we must do everything that we can to ensure that the United Nations are understanding that people are watching them, and you know, these are our fellow human beings. It was a real pleasure today to watch my colleague, Frasiab, Councillor Anwar, at the Labour Party conference, getting a standing ovation for his mentions today. Stand by everything he said, and I'm really pleased that we brought this motion tonight. Thank you.
Sorry, thank you. Councillor Khan.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Normally in the chair of Deputy Mayor, I try not to intervene too much, but this is such a grave contribution for myself. It's an area which I am personally passionate about. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm not from Kashmiri background, because the truth of the matter is, you do not have to be from the Kashmiri background or Muslim background, whatever background. This is about humanity. It's about human suffering. And I look at this exclusively from the angle of human rights violations. And I congratulate Councillor Arif Khan to bring this motion to the council today. But just imagine this: somebody, central government, locked up our council leader. I might disagree with him, but I do not want to see you locked up. But we might have disagreements. But that is what's happened. The leadership in Kashmir has been locked up. There's a curfew. These things which we can't live, which we take for granted here in the United Kingdom in Burnley, they can't access anything. Loved ones in the gallery, family, friends, relatives, they cannot get through to their loved ones. And that is a travesty of the situation. So I urge all of you today, all of us, to just show compassion and send a strong message to those people that are suffering. Because if that was us here in Burnley under curfew, I'd expect somebody to raise their voice for us, because this is what humanity is about. So I won't go on for too long, and the history has been very clearly outlined. But just to finish off with the quote of the great President Kennedy, he said the only thing necessary for the triumph of evil is that good men and women do nothing. Let's not do nothing. Let's be the international community here in Burnley and send a strong message to the government, to the Foreign Secretary, that we care about them young children who have been pellet gunshot and them women being raped and tortured. We care about them. We are their voice, and we want to see peace and prosperity in that part of the world. So thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
Councillor Newhouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'd just like to reiterate basically what the other councillors have said, and it is more about the humanity side of it. No matter which sides are arguing and falling out, it's happened in other places in the world. We see it regularly now, unfortunately. I would like to point out what the government's stance is and a few other little points to make note. But I do again thank you for bringing the motion. I thought of amending it. There could be more diplomatic ways of saying the things that you're trying to say to the people you're trying to say them to, but in the end we've decided to leave it as it is. But I'd just like to say the United Nations had a long maintained institutional presence in the contested area of Kashmir. The position of the United Nations on the region is governed by a charter and applicable Security Council resolutions. We must recall the 1972 agreement on bilateral relations between India and Pakistan. This states that the final status of Kashmir is to be settled by peaceful means in accordance with the UN Charter. Britain's High Commissioner in India has said that the UK stance on Kashmir has not changed, and Kashmir issue must be resolved bilaterally between India and Pakistan by taking into account the wishes of the Kashmiri people. The Prime Minister has stressed that it is for the India and Pakistan to find a long-lasting solution to the Kashmiri issue in accordance with the wishes of the Kashmiri people. He has also reiterated that the government's stance in Kashmir has described both India and Pakistan as important partners to the UK. The government's long-standing position remains that it is for India and Pakistan to find long-lasting political solutions to the situation in Kashmir in accordance with the wishes of the region's people. Both India and Pakistan are indeed most important partners. And I think that's where it really comes to the issue, because I've heard it mentioned this week that we do shout at other nations and other countries when they have these sort of issues, but we are such close partners with India and Pakistan, and it then becomes very, very difficult to have a say. And other than what we are doing, which is one, as a council, we're writing to the people, the MPs, the Foreign Secretary, and I'd suggest the Minister for, I think it's the Asian part, in that direction. And again, as members of this council, we can write ourselves to the MPs to get them to look at this, and this will then hopefully push them into looking more deeply at the situation. But when you have such close partners with other countries like Pakistan and India, it is slightly different than in other situations in the world, and all we can try and do is give recommendations and hope the UN can go back in and set about putting the laws that have changed recently so that the people of Kashmir can go back to a much more peaceful lifestyle. Thank you very much, Madam Mayor.
Councillor Raja.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. First of all, I would like to thank everyone who has stood up today in support of Kashmir. Being of Kashmiri origin, I condemn the atrocities our brothers and sisters are facing in occupied Kashmir. This is a humanitarian crisis. Their pain and suffering is felt by thousands, if not millions of people around the world. I want us all today to stand in solidarity with our oppressed brothers and sisters and support this motion. This is a crucial point in time to reassure the people of Kashmir that we will be their voice and fight against injustices that they are facing. Thank you very much.
Councillor Birtwistle.
Thank you, thank you, Madam Mayor. Could I say how pleased I was to see Zakir Ali back in this council chamber once again, speaking on behalf of Kashmir as he did many, many years ago, and it's great to see him back. This to me is a situation that has been created by a Commonwealth country. India is a Commonwealth country. They are part of our Commonwealth, yet what is our Commonwealth doing about it? I can see nothing. We have a foreign secretary. In fact, we've had numerous foreign secretaries since this crisis came about, and they've sat on their hands and done nothing about it. I am extremely concerned about the ethnic cleansing that could begin to happen in that part of the world. We've seen it happen in Myanmar. where all the Muslim community are being forced out of Myanmar because of ethnic cleansing. It worries me that the Indian government will start to ethnic cleanse this part of Kashmir. And this is why I believe that the government needs to get their act together. I believe that the Foreign Secretary should start making moves to speak to the, never mind, but they are part of the Commonwealth. He needs to speak to the Prime Minister of India and the Prime Minister of Pakistan, because it is a worrying state of affairs around there, to explain and tell them that as the UK and as part of the Commonwealth, they can't do things like this. This is A, illegal, and B, we can't treat residents that are part of our Commonwealth like they're being treated. Now, various members have said about the rape of ladies, the effect, the cruelty to young children in the area. This is an appalling situation. And for our Foreign Secretary and our Prime Minister to just sit on their hands and let this go without even bringing it to the United Nations to start with, which they haven't done, or even approaching the perpetrators of this, the Indian government, who I say are getting millions and millions of pounds off this country every year, why they are not approaching them and laying down the law to say, if you're in the Commonwealth, you cannot do this. You've got to get this sorted out. And I support this motion. I think it's an excellent motion. It's one of the best motions we've ever had at this council for the 37 years I've been on it. And I will definitely be supporting it.
Councillor Ishtiak.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Firstly, I'd like to thank Councillor Khan and other speakers to come and talk about this important issue. This is very dear to me, colleagues, because I am from Kashmir, Pakistani administered Kashmir, and I belong to a prominent Sufi family from Kashmir. And I have seen people who have migrated from Jammu, Kashmir, to our village, and the lives that they've affected and what they've left behind. And they still have families back in Jammu, Kashmir. Unfortunately, they cannot go back because of the restrictions. This issue is not about India. It's not about Pakistan. It's not about Muslim. It's not about Hindus. It's about humanity. This concerns us, all of us, especially the great nation we are here as British. Wherever injustices happens, we're the first one. But when it comes to Kashmir, unfortunately, we're very silent. There are young children that have been pelletized. We all witnessed to it. There's women that are being raped. There are politicians that have been elected, like all of us here, are locked up, as Councillor Khan has just said. That is what's happening in today's society. Some would say, how is this relevant to Burnley? What has it got to do with Burnley? I personally feel it has a lot, because our history is connected. People from Kashmir descent came here, worked in the mills. They contributed to our economy. They made that difference to our well-being, to our economic state. We, as Burnley residents, have that duty to stand up for their rights, speak up, write to the Prime Minister, write to the Foreign Secretary. It's under our duty. And I think we should, in whatever capacity we are here today, as my friends and my elders in the chamber and my colleagues here, from whatever party you're from, I urge you to write to the relevant people and stand up for human beings. It's not about Hindu, it's not about Muslim, it's not about India, it's not about Pakistan, it's about human issue. And we've stood up for other nations, and I think we too, as Kashmiris, deserve the right. When I came to this country at the age of 10, 11, in 1982, I went to Barden School. I made some friends. And I was taught Britain always stood up for poor, underprivileged, oppressed people. And I've seen it. We have done. But unfortunately, when it comes to my country, my people, it's very silent. So I'm going to get emotion. I urge you, in whatever capacity you are sat here today, to please stand up and express your anger and dissatisfaction, the modern day genocide that's happening today in Kashmir. Thank you very much. Thank you, Councillor Khan.
Councillor Anwar.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Do you hear that, colleagues? That is the sound of silence. And I want to remind you of something that this council stands for. Every single year, I attend the Holocaust Memorial Service. And a few words are read out there. And the words that are read out, I'm going to remind you of them. First, they came for the socialists. I did not speak out because I wasn't a socialist. Then they came for the trade unionists. I didn't speak out because I was not a trade unionist. Then they came for the Jews. I did not speak out because I was not a Jew. Then they came for me. But there was nobody left to speak for me. I want you to think of those words, and it's very important that all of us speak out. And as you heard, I've been in Brighton this week, and I spoke out. And I thought it was important that I speak out on this really, really important issue. And one of the things that I touched on there was that I'm proud of this town. I'm proud to be a Northerner. I'm proud to be a Burnley lad. And the reason I'm proud of that is because whenever people have tried to come here to promote hatred or division, we have fought that. In this chamber, out there, in our communities, in our streets. This is a very, very important issue. Very important. So important that I went to Brighton and I missed my niece's wedding so I could be a voice for the Kashmiris. That's how important it is. And then I drove all the way back after speaking this morning just so I could have my voice heard again on behalf of the Kashmiri people. That's how important it is. So we could have this debate and I could be a part of that. I'm not a Kashmiri. But as colleagues have touched on it, there is a genocide happening. People are being murdered, women are being raped, children are being shot at. And we cannot afford to be silent anymore. And putting party politics aside, Labour Party conference unanimously voted for that motion. Wouldn't it be brilliant if everybody in this chamber did the same? Thank you.
Madam Mayor, I totally concur with the content of this motion, and I'd like to thank all the councillors concerned who brought this forward. However, there is just one word of warning. It is very easy to fan the flames of hate, and I'm very pleased that Councillor did make the point of saying this was not Muslim, this was not Hindu, it was not Indian, it was not Pakistani. It is very easy in that part of the world to find the walls built up between each of these communities. We've seen it in the war in 1971 East Pakistan. So we must be careful how this proceeds diplomatically, because at the end of the day, we do not wish to have a civil war on our hands, which would do much more damage than almost anything else we would have wished for. Thank you.
Councillor Ferrier.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I will not pretend for a moment that I'm as learned about Kashmir as some of the members in this chamber, but I will slightly compare it to an area which is quite close to my man outside this chamber. Some of the things committed against its own people in China, for example. We now studied its recent history, especially Maoist China, for a long time. And for example, in Xinjiang province, there's over 1 million Muslims detained in re-education camps there. So how that makes me feel is angry and frustrated. And it's a bit like with Kashmir, it makes me feel the same. Angry and frustrated. Angry and frustrated at the unhumane crimes committed against the Kashmiri people, against a state that they have very little power to fight against. So this motion tonight, I do hope our political differences will melt away and we'll stand together, as small as a token as it might be internationally, that it will show the Kashmir people in part, and I hope many councils will do the same, that we are standing with them. We are standing for the right thing. We are standing for humanity and freedom, and above all, peace, because it must end peacefully. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Councillor Hussain.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. And I welcome this motion and I will be supporting it. I think the issues around human rights abuses has been long been documented, both in various places, United Nations and Human Rights Watch. And it's been stated that many of these crimes have been committed by the Indian security forces. And this is not me making things up. This is, you can find this information, and it's, you know, it's documented by Human Rights Watch, by United Nations. There is a systematic assault and torture and execution of civilians, in particular targeting civil campaigners and their families. And what's made me think about this and even sickens me more is that they highlight rape as something that they use, and they say rape is a tool of war, and they use that so that the family is then humiliated and dehumanized. And I mean, and this is carried out by the Indian security forces. And not only that, not only United Nations are saying it, there was a report in 2010 carried out by the United States State Department, and which concluded that extrajudicial killings of civilians and the suppression of freedom of speech has been carried out by the Indian Army and the Indian government there. And not only that, in terms of the atrocities that are happening, even the Indian-owned government, they've got a cabinet committee on security, and it has highlighted in the 80s and in the 90s that there's been increasing number of deaths in Kashmir attributed to the Indian Army, and that's the government, Indian government's own findings. So it's really important that we write strongly to our foreign minister, as said in the motion, that, like Councillor Birtwistle said, India is a Commonwealth country. It has close trading links with the UK. And as such, we should use those links to tell the Indian government that this is not acceptable at all. And I hope all members support this and show solidarity. Thank you.
Councillor Gordon Lishman.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I add my support generally to what people are saying here, but I want to add 2 points. The first is strongly to support those colleagues who talked about the abuse of human rights in other contexts. I haven't directly been involved in Kashmir. I have, however, attended meetings of the UN Committee on Human Rights and heard a great deal about a number of other parts of the world. And sometimes we should think not just about the most direct connection with our own town and our own citizens, but about some of the principles of human rights which apply everywhere and to everyone. The other thing I want to say is just to comment on the suggestion that this is not, for instance, about Hindus and Muslims. What is happening in Kashmir is a direct result of a Hindu populist movement being elected to power in India. It's a direct result of the Modi government's choice to pursue election by stigmatizing significant parts of its Muslim population. That's not only about Kashmir, it's also about Nagaland, and it is about the high barbed wire fence which now surrounds Bangladesh to keep Muslim citizens of Bangladesh from entering India. And that will become one of the world's major trouble spots if we see a rise in sea levels as a result of global warming. The point I want to make, therefore, about religion is that religion can be seized upon and used in democratic states and in undemocratic ones as a means of mobilizing support for a government and its position. And of course, we're seeing that with Israel and Palestine at present. If we want to resolve these things and look at the work that people like the International Crisis Group do in trying to resolve those things, it is as important as condemning violations of human rights as they occur, also to make the case for the opposite, for open, pluralist democracy, and for politicians who stand up for the rights of all their citizens. We've seen a diminution now with the rise of the populist tide across the world, not only in India, and I think it's all of our responsibilities to stand up for human rights rather than to spend our time, as sometimes we do, talking about the rights of our own citizens, people of our own religion, people of our own race, people of our own background. And I really want to say that people here who vote for this and who support it quite rightly need to think just a little more widely as well about the issues which affect the rest of the world at the same time.
Councillor Khan.
I'm not taking your time. It's already 3/4 of an hour gone. Yeah. May I, from bottom of my heart, may I thank all the members who said a few words about the Kashmiris, and that's touched not just my heart, the, all over the world, because the media is there, so it's going to be seen in all over the world. Yeah. So thank you so much, all the councillors.
Thank you, Councillor Khan. Can we now move to the vote? We've agreed that we would have a named vote. So for, are we for or against the motion?
Thanks, Member. Councillor Anwar.
For.
Baker.
For.
Birtwistle.
For.
Briggs.
For.
Brindle.
For.
Campbell.
For.
Kant.
For.
Chowdhury.
For.
Comis.
For.
Emo. Ferrier, Fewins, Foster, Gill, Graham, Hall, Harbour, Hosker, Hussain, Ishtiak, Johnston, Kelly, Khan Arif, Khan Lubna, Khan Shabana, Khan Wajid, Lishman Gordon, Lishman Margaret, Lone, McCann, Martin, Mahana, Mottised, Newhouse, Payne, Payne, Emma. Sorry, did I say Payne there? I said Pate. Yeah, sorry, I'll go back there. Sorry, members. I'll go back to Councillor Liam Pate. Payne, Emma. Payne Mark,
four.
Raja,
four.
Roper,
four.
Royal,
four.
Sumner,
four.
Tatchell,
four.
Townley,
four.
Townsend.
I'm glad to say the motion has been carried unanimously. Can we now move on to item 6 on the agenda, items for decision by the council. Can I point out to members that items for decision by council are treated as motions. Once a proposal has been moved and seconded, members may speak once and for a maximum of 5 minutes. Members may then only speak again on an amendment. Please note that a list of nominations to the Police and Crime Panel for item 6B has been circulated around the chamber this evening. The relevant minute extracts from the executive relating to item 6E to G have been published as part of the agenda, with the decisions for council highlighted in bold. Please also note that the minute extracts from the executive for item 6H to G have been published separately as a supplement on your iPads.
Madam Chairman, on the point of order, I don't think we've got those, the Police and Crime Commissioner stuff.
We haven't got enough. Ah, oh, yeah, we haven't got enough nominations.
It's been covered in.
Yeah, we'll cover it when
yeah,
we get
so we'll cover it when we get to it, that's why. There haven't been any nominations. Yeah. Item 6A on the agenda. But we'll let them go.
Yeah.
Item 6A, review of polling districts, places and stations. Councillor Charlie Briggs, will you move the report?
I move the report, Madam Mayor.
Councillor Margaret Lishman, will you second the report?
Second the report, Madam Mayor.
Any member? Councillor Townley.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just briefly to say how delighted I am to see that democracy has been returned to York Mill, where our missing polling station has been reinstated. We look forward to filling it with many votes. Democratically, of course. Next May.
That's what goes in. All in favour, please show. Thank you. Those against? The item is carried. Item 6B on the agenda, appointments to committees and outside bodies. The Council is seeking replacement members on the Lancashire Police and Crime Panel for one independent or other party member and two substitutes, again from an independent or other party, which is needed to maintain the political balance of that panel across all Lancashire authorities. That means that we can't accept nominations from the Liberal Democrats, the Labour Group or the Conservative Group. One nomination has been received, that of Councillor Hosker as lead member on that panel. Are there any other nominations for those positions? No? Okay. Councillor Briggs, will you move the list of appointments to committees, working groups and outside bodies as in the report, and the list of nominations to the Police and Crime Panel as circulated this evening? And we haven't had any more nominations.
I'll move the list, Madam Mayor.
Okay. Councillor Margaret Lishman, will you second that report?
Second the report, Madam
Mayor. All those in favour, please show. Okay. Those against? The item is carried. Item 6C on the agenda, constitutional updates. Councillor Charles Briggs, will you move the report?
I move the report, Madam Mayor.
Councillor Margaret Lishman, will you second the report?
Second the report, Madam Mayor.
Any member? We go straight to the vote. Those in favour, please show. You. Those against? The item is carried. Item 6D on the agenda, complaint under the Code of Conduct. Councillor Payne.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I present to Council the findings of the hearing panel as set out in the decision notice before you tonight.
Thank you, Councillor Payne. Members, that's noted. Okay. Item 6E on the agenda, the strategic plans. Councillor Charles Briggs, will you move the report?
I move the report, Madam Mayor.
Councillor Margaret Lishman, will you second the report?
Second the report, Madam Mayor.
Councillor Baker, I understand that you wish to move an amendment to the report. Will you please propose that amendment?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just to say it's pleasing
to get this report from the new administration, and basically following what we've always had for a few years now. I think most of the council are in agreement on our way forward, but it's good to see the addition of one or two other items. However, while I was rooting through this one and reading through it again, I did notice one item which I propose an amendment to, and that is on page 76, and it's item PL2, which currently states, we will improve the management and condition of private rented accommodation. Now, I'm sure members did not wish to say that we have no concerns or we do not care about the people in social housing. So I would suggest that we drop the word private, which will then we will improve the management and condition of rented accommodation in general, which will then cover social housing as well as private sector accommodation. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and I move that motion.
Councillor Birtwistle, will you second that amendment?
I'll second that amendment, Madam Mayor, and reserve the right to speak if required.
Thank you. Councillor Briggs and Councillor Lishman, are you happy to accept the proposed amendment?
I am, Madam Mayor.
Councillor Lishman. Thank you. So, members, the substantive motion now reads that Council approves the strategic plan, subject to strategic plan priority PL2 being revised to read, we will improve the management and condition of rented accommodation. Any member? Councillor Townsend.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just to say, regarding the amendments, we're fully supportive of that. It was an item that came up at scrutiny, and we're quite clear that, as far as we are concerned, it looked like there was a two-tier system within the rented sector within Burnley, where there was a trusted status if you were social and untrusted if you were private, the way it was written. So quite happy with the amendments and taking out the word private. In terms of just generally around the strategic plan, obviously we recognise that there is a new administration and it's under new leadership, and you have the right to implement and write your own strategic plan. I think it's about 85% what it was previously, with some additions. Some of those additions we do agree with, because we discussed them at the last council meeting, like the climate change emergency and things like that, and we're delighted that those are now within the strategic plan, and we look forward to the results from the working group that's been set up. I think there is one major area of concern where really the council can be seen as looking inward rather than outwards, and that is certainly around the item that says a review of the governance structures, and we're all aware that's called for basically rewriting the constitution and restructuring the way this council is governed, and we think on this side that would be a completely wrong time to do this with all the uncertainty that's around. We need to be outward looking and not inward looking. There's not a lot wrong with the governance structures that we have now that couldn't be put right. Nothing wrong with a review, I accept that, but I think we all know in this chamber, and you know, it's a lot more than a review, what you're suggesting. So we'll be certainly, we will be abstaining on that point. But I will have, I do want to ask the Leader of the Council one specific question regarding this programme, and it's item PR4 within the strategic plan, which says we will implement the local plan, delivering new housing, employment sites and infrastructure. And we all know that it was a very contentious issue over about 3 or 4 years to get the local plan in place, and it was adopted in July 2018. So it's really good news that you're deciding to say we will implement that local plan despite those reservations that you had. But since taking control, I just want you to confirm that you are basically that ambition is sincere, and you're not looking at any other work in terms of tearing up the plan, changing the plan, alternatives to the plan that could really undermine the confidence that residents have, developers have, investors have, that we have now a firm plan that was adopted in July 2018 and we want to see through and go with full vigour on all sites employment, housing to get them built so we can build an aspirational Burnley. So if you can give us that reassurance that nobody's been tasked with doing anything else but delivering the local plan, I think that would be good news. But we will be abstaining on this issue tonight. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Any member? Councillor Briggs, do you want to respond to that?
Yeah. Sorry about coughing. I've got a very sore throat. Sorry, Mark. All it is, I've raised concerns about the housing numbers, and we just still be looking at the options, what we've got. No decisions have been made yet, and I will honestly, 100%, if there is any decisions being made, you'll be one of the first to find out. So, and the rest of the council. So I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Councillor Townley.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I have to say, that's a bit rich coming from the Labour group. It's plans that you put in place, scarcely taking note of anything any of us put in. So to then believe that we cannot generate and consolidate, and to make out that we will be tearing anything up, that we, on the other hand, do not wish see Burnley to take its natural right place in the other boroughs, in the county and in the country, is indeed disgraceful. That we may wish to change things is our prerogative. We have different views from you. They are no more right and possibly much better than yours. I really do think that to try and tie our hands by implying that we don't have the best interests of the people of Burnley at heart is unconscionable.
Point of personal explanation, Madam Mayor. I didn't actually say that you weren't allowed to have a change of heart or change anything. Never said that. What I'm asking...
Okay.
You've had your turn. What I did say was the local plan says we will implement the local plan. Now, if you're going to do something different, be honest to the people of Burnley. I have no problem with that. You have the right to write your own plan. But don't put things in a plan that could be perceived as being dishonest. If you're doing something different, if you're diverting resources to do something that's different, to not implementing that local plan, then tell us. You've got that right as an administration, but you ain't got the right to lie to the people of Burnley if that's not what you're doing. So Councillor Briggs didn't actually say we are implementing with full vigour the 2018 local plan adopted in July. If he wants to say that, fine. But if he wants to say we are looking at other options, absolutely
Madam Mayor,
fine.
Madam Mayor, point of
Thank
order,
you.
Madam Mayor.
That's my point of personal explanation. Thank you.
Rather long.
Councillor Pate.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just to say that I'm very pleased to see this come forward as an amendment. Obviously, I was the member that brought it to scrutiny, having seen for many years the robust system that we do have within this council for dealing with issues around private rented sector, and just wanting to really make sure that as a council we've got that reinforced for every resident living in rented sector in Burnley, not just for the private rented sector, so that it's a full platform for anybody, no matter what type of housing you're living in. So thank you for bringing that tonight.
Thank you. Councillor Newhouse.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I think the point was made quite clear by the leader of the council that we have had discussions to look at what may happen with the local plan. Over the next 10 or 15 years, items in this town are going to change, maybe the number of buildings is going to change. There are lots of things that could happen for this plan. It's not fixed in stone the way it is. We're looking to implement it in the way it says in the minutes, and if anything changes from that, like the leader said, he would come back to us and inform us of any changes. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
A number of points. In relation to the local plan, I stand by what is written in the strategic plan at the moment, but I will remind Council that at the last Council meeting we did pass a motion regarding the climate emergency, and therefore I would expect, as part of due process, that the local plan would be reviewed in relation to anything that comes out from that particular motion in relation to the climate emergency. That's not saying that we are going to change it. it is making an observation that it would need to be looked at in the light of the motion that this council has passed. In relation to the comments that Councillor Townsend made regarding the governance review, I realise that the Labour Party on that side of the chamber see governance review equals committee system and are unable to look at anything other than the old committee system that we had. A governance review is what it is. The intention that was put forward was that we would look at means of making sure that more councillors had a clear say in what happened within this council rather than simply an executive making those decisions on their own. The means by which that will be done is a matter for a governance review, and that is what this document mentions. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Matt. I actually was going to make the same point as Councillor Lishman there, just in relation to a climate emergency motion that was passed at last council. As chair of the working group, I will want to listen to the views of residents in the town and the international government, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change report in relation to carbon emissions and global warming is actually more recent than the local plan. So it is only right that we take that into consideration. And if the working group and the residents of Burnley feel that that needs to be looked at, then hopefully we will be able to do that with an open mind. And just in relation to the government's governance review, I just want to say that I welcome that. I do think that the council needs to be more open, transparent and democratic, and I hope that will be the result of that review.
I'll second that report, Madam Mayor.
The net budget forecast and the achievements of savings targets. This approach shows the current forecast outturn position based on the savings forecast within the current reporting period. So it doesn't necessarily show us a break-even position at the end. It's showing what would happen if we did nothing else after this particular period of time. So it's just to make sure that members are clear of what they're seeing.
I second the report, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Can I ask a question under 9.1, paragraph 9.1 on page 101 of the report? Under economy and growth, it shows salary savings in respect of the town centre management post. And I was wondering what was happening with this town centre management post. Has the post been filled? And if not, why not? Because I feel that post is crucial, both in the run-up to Christmas and for engagement in the Burnley Town Centre bid project that's ongoing at the moment. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor Graham, for the question. I don't know the answer, but I will make absolutely sure you get one, if not by the end of this meeting, by first thing tomorrow morning.
I second that report, Madam Mayor.
I do wish to move an amendment, Madam Mayor, hopefully for distribution now by officers, and can obviously I think it's probably worth us taking a few minutes just to read it, and then I'll move it.
I'll second that, Madam Mayor.
Yes, Councillor. This item relates to council tax premium and policy, which I think is great, but the amendment reads about what to do with the revenue raised from this amendment.
No.
Are we on to something else yet? In which case, I'll shut up and sit down. Sorry.
Yes.
Sorry.
So I should move the council tax premium and policy. Yes? Is that what I'm doing? And then, wait.
I will move the alteration to the amendment. The amendment being that replacing the word ring fences what was the second word?
Consider contributing.
So the first two words of section three change to consider contributing. And that's the amendment. Everything else stays as is. I move that amendment.
Point of order. Before we do this, I would still like to comment that this item, the amendment to this item, is nothing to do with the original item. It is due to the revenue raised by this. Now, I still feel it needs to be read in its entirety as it stands at the moment. And if you don't wish to do that, then I would propose that we move it to a later date in the council agenda. It's not until legal advice is sought. Because if you don't do a council thing on how we're going to raise money, then immediately spend how we're going to spend it or ring-fence it at the same time.
Madam Mayor, thank you very much. I think Councillor Baker raises a point which is covered within the Constitution. I think it's a fair point which is made by him. I think what you're trying to get at, correct me if I'm wrong, Councillor Baker, for mistaking you, but Councillor Townsend's proposed an amendment to the motion. Rule 14.6, and I'll enunciate just for effect really here, says an amendment to a motion must be relevant to the motion, and that's the point that he's referring to. So the first element of the amendment as with regards to ring fencing or consider contributing the additional revenue is sufficient, but the rest of it is the one he's questioning. In accordance with the council procedure rules, Councillor Baker's raised a point of order, and it's ultimately your decision, but it is a fair point that's been raised by Councillor Baker. Councillor Baker, do you have any questions on that? Sorry. Yeah.
Well said. Thank you. So where are we at now? Do we need to vote on the amendment?
No.
Are they agreed?
No. Are you allowing the amendment?
Madam Mayor, sorry, a point of order. If you're considering what Councillor Baker has just said in terms of its relevance and should it be treated as an amendment, I would like to just add a few words in terms of that. The proposal itself, yes, it talks about housing, but I think it's clear it's not under Councillor Emo's portfolio. It's actually under Councillor Lishman's portfolio, which is resources, and it affects resources as well. So that might be a mistake, it might not, but it's certainly come here to this full council in terms of it is a resources issue that affects resources, and that's why this council is considering it. It does not materially increase or decrease expenditure. In fact, it makes the report actually neutral. In terms of, because there's a £47,000 statement in there, and it actually talks about how the amendment talks about how we may use that. And para 6 and para 9 is saying it's not intended to generate any income, and the amendment supports that. It's basically a redistribution of the revenue that's generated from one place to another within council tax, not going outside of council tax. Within council tax. It only commits the council to a consultation at this stage. Basically, all we're saying is basically this would be the proposal that goes out to consultation, and who knows what might happen from that consultation. The precedence for ring fencing has been set by this council, and I think I discussed it last time. We had an issue where we brought Kingdom in to do certain work within the borough and litter enforcement, and any revenue generated was ring fenced for other purposes. And at the last full council meeting, we had a debate when I raised an amendment in terms of ring fencing resources from the recycling scheme, household recycling, to street cleansing and climate change emergency. Now that fell, but we didn't have this debate that it didn't relate, so the precedence has been set in terms of allocating money and refencing or contributing. So as it's under the resources portfolio, I think it's perfectly valid to have a decision made about where you're going to allocate those resources. And I think it's perfectly valid. Thank you, Madam Mayor. For you to review.
Point of order again, Chair. I would argue with Councillor Townsend just on the fact that if we did it wrong last time, it doesn't give us leave to do it wrong every time. So just because one decision was made, it doesn't set a precedent. I would move that, I don't think I can move the motion at this time, but the motion I will move when at the appropriate time will be to put this item onto next council meeting agenda when we can all have a bit more time to think about it. So I still think it's wrong to conflate the two.
A point of order, Madam Mayor, because I will just come to timescales here. If it's delayed to the next meeting, then it just falls completely because there won't be time for a consultation period between the December full council and basically the budget meeting.
Thank you, Madam Mayor.
I am with the wording being changed. Yes, thank you.
I am, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Mayor. I think that we're talking about passing the amendment now. Sorry, there's quite a lot gone on, so I'm talking about the amendment. I welcome the amendment. I am really pleased to see that we're going in the right direction in relation to the vulnerable people in our town. I was really disappointed 6 months ago when the entire Labour Party voted down my feel poverty motion. I felt like that was taking us in the wrong direction. And after 5 or 6 years of maximum council tax rises for the town, I'm glad to see their change of direction on this. I would have supported the motion with the ring fencing, without the ring fencing, because I think that to be clear to the people in the public gallery, that this is really a sort of statement of intent of where we want to go. There's nothing binding in this motion that requires us to ring fence this money and use it for this purpose, because it is a statutory consultation and we cannot predetermine the result of that statutory consultation. So therefore, all this is an indication of the direction we want to take for our town and start looking after vulnerable people, and I'm really, really pleased to see that we're doing that.
Vote.
Four or amendment.
Councillor Anwar.
For.
Baker.
For.
Birtwistle.
For.
Briggs.
For.
Brindle.
For.
Campbell.
For.
Cant.
For.
Chowdhury.
For.
Comis.
For.
Emo.
For.
Ferrier.
For.
Fewins.
For.
Foster.
For.
Gill.
For.
Graham.
For.
Hall.
For.
Harbour.
For.
Oscar. Ishtiak,
four.
Johnston,
four.
Kelly,
four.
Khan Arif,
four.
Khan Lubna,
four.
Khan Shabana,
four.
Khan Wajid,
four.
Lishman Gordon,
four.
Lishman Margaret,
four.
Lone, McCann,
four.
Martin,
four.
Mahana,
four.
Mottishead,
four.
Newhouse,
four.
Pate, Payne, Emma. Payne, Mark.
Four.
Raja.
Four.
Roper.
Four.
Royal.
Four.
Sumner.
Four.
Tatchell.
Four.
Townley.
Gates.
Townsend.
Four.
Well, the amendment's carried. So now we need to move on to the motion, be a substantive motion. Do you have any member first?
No.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So the motion's accepted, yeah. Motion.
Yeah.
Right.
I second the report, Madam Mayor. Second report, Madam Mayor.
We understand what this report is all about because we've gone through it for quite a number of years now. What I do see within this report, though, is that actually the conditions, even though they're out for the next couple of years, are quite challenging, very challenging. In the next financial year, actually, it's the most benign year that we've probably had for a decade when you look at council grant funding and what's now being assumed in the MTFS. In fact, when you look at table 2 on page 136 right at the top, it actually says under funding that there's actually a £30,000 increase this year from some of the massive drops that we've had over recent years. In fact, only in February, we were looking at a £610,000 decrease as an assumption. So better news on the funding front, and obviously, not gonna be churlish about that, that's welcome, because we've had some really tough times and had some to make some really tough decisions over the last few years. Obviously, we'll be coming back to this report in February. We see that there was £277,000 worth of savings already agreed, and this adds to it with another £248,000, because even though the funding's gone up, we do appreciate the costs go up as well, and you know, savings are required. The £30,000, we're never going to cover that. What is alarming to me, though, is, and perhaps you can answer this, Councillor Lishman, in paragraph 6 at the bottom of 134, it basically says the continuation estimate in February was £330,000 increase in growth. When you look at table 2, where we are now, it's £650,000. where on earth has the extra cost come from just in the continuation estimate? If it hadn't doubled the cost increase over the last 6 months, we'd actually be in a surplus now. You wouldn't have to make another single saving between now. In fact, you'd have probably about £120,000 worth in surplus already to put towards future year savings. So for the life of me, I have absolutely no idea why that continuation estimate has doubled over the last 6 months. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
As I think Councillor Townsend mentioned, costs don't stand still. And there have been increased costs to the council over this 6 months. We had a period where there was no work at all being done in the town hall on the capital elements, and we've had to fund that through additional costs that we've, loans that we've taken in. Everything goes up all the time for us, and I think his approach of us, this being a benign year is an interesting phrase. We're left in a position where we're just finishing a four-year period for a spending review, and we were expected to enter into another four-year spending review for a variety of reasons, mainly because this government, or whichever government it is at the moment, or whichever face it is of the Tories, is busy with Brexit. They've decided that they're not going to do that, and we're going to end up with a spending review for 1 year only. So to say that we know that we're going to be better off is an interesting phrase for us all. He does point out that costs have gone up. Income has also gone down for the council in some areas that we need to make up the difference. Charter Walk, where we had large amounts of money coming from, that income has dropped, I think, by approximately 10% due to empty properties in there, so that there are continue to be changes. And the medium financial strategy is not a set document. It is a dynamic document. It is a fluid document that will continue to change. And things may well be very different when we sit down in this council chamber again in December. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I move my report, and in doing so, for the members of scrutiny, the two working groups, we have dates for their inaugural meetings. The railway working group is the 29th of October, and the housing disrepair issues group is the 16th of January. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just before I move my report, I'd just like to thank all the staff, the emergency services and partners, organisations, plus Tesco's, for all their support yesterday in dealing with the suspect device at the cricket club and the evacuation to St Peter's Centre. I think they did a fantastic job, and they should be praised up to the hilt. It was absolutely fantastic watching them when I got there. And I'm sorry, I forgot somebody else. Not forgetting Councillor Townley, as she worked her socks off yesterday afternoon
when people were coming in because they didn't know how to do it and when to do it, and she was quite calm and collective. First time I've seen her do that for the last 12 years, but never mind. But thank you very much indeed, and I move the report, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor, and I'd just like to say I join with those words that Councillor Briggs used about the emergency services, and I believe there was a couple of incidents at the end, but certainly the one at Turf Moor that affected certainly my residents in Brunshire directly as well, so thank you, fully support those words. Two questions. One is PE1, page 150, regarding educational attainment, and again, perhaps it's something that's not written that I thought would have been, was the situation around Thomas Whittam. I just asked the leader if the response to the consultation that this council will be making regarding the proposed closure of Thomas Whittam can be basically brought to the next full council meeting, which I think is in October, so it's in good time for the end of the consultation, which is in November, so we can have a full agreement on what that consultation response will be from Burnley Council, so hopefully he can agree to that. And secondly, on PR1, page 151, can you just, the East Lancashire University Enterprise Zone sounds really exciting and sounds like something we should all get behind. Can you just elaborate a little and tell us a little bit more about what that will be, what it entails us to be able to do, and what practically it's actually going to deliver for us as a town? Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Yeah, I'll come on to those two. With the first question on the PE1 150, Thomas Whittam. Yes, I totally agree that we've got to sort this out. I am not in favour of losing another school in Burnley, especially the one at Thomas Whittam, because from what I've heard is that they was going to take it out of town and place it in Nelson or Colne or somewhere like that, and I can't abide our children, our teenagers, going out of town on buses, having to be, you know, treated like that. So I'm quite happy to try to bring it back to the full council at next meeting. So we'll be looking into that. Thank you very much indeed for bringing that up. The second one about the university thing. It's just bringing everything into the town, as you very well know, because you were part of it originally. And I'm quite pleased that you turned my building into a UCLAN building. So I must be appreciative of that. It's just bringing everybody into the town and getting Burnley further education and making sure that people expect a lot of things from Burnley, i.e. Pioneer Place, if we can get that sorted, the lower St. James Street, when that's going to be sorted, and making sure, if we can, bringing some new shops into the town centre to up the funding, and getting more people from out of town into the town, in purely educational. I hope that's okay for you, councillor. So thank you.
Thank you. I won't say as much because I think we've got the gist of Councillor Briggs's views. But PE1 again on page 150. It was just to say, can we urge those that are doing the consultation and those parents and those that may be parents of future children going to Thomas Whittam to understand what the difference is between a college education at that age and between a sixth form education, because they're very different. And I think people who've never touched that part of education don't understand how much children who go to the sixth forms need those sixth forms as an option, because it is a very different option to a college. And I wouldn't like to see this town have one less option for young people when all we do is complain about, oh, they're not doing this and they're not doing that. Let's give them the opportunities to thrive. But please, would you represent those people that need a sixth form option? Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Again, it's page 150, PE1, Under that strategic commitment, Madam Mayor, it talks about how we will work with partners to make the borough a place of aspiration, and I think we all agree with that. Unfortunately, there was an article in the Telegraph this week regarding the Empire Theatre, and I think there was some vandalism in there which caused an asbestos problem, and they had to close the theatre down. The leader was asked for a quote from the Telegraph, and to be fair, I thought it was a wonderful quote, what a give. And he said that the Empire is a special place to me. I spent much of my childhood there when it was a cinema. Hopefully, this is just a minor setback, and the council will do what it can to help the trust. My question is, what is the council going to do to help the trust?
Yeah, I'll reply. Obviously, I'll go with Councillor Pates first. Like I said, you know, I'm fully behind the school. I'm 100% behind it. I want it to be maintained. I will, if I need to, go and speak to Lancashire County Council leader and put our case forward. That's if Thomas Whittam will want me to do that. And I do feel that we need to get out to the parents and let them know the difference between the two. And I'll certainly try my best to do that. Going back to the other question, yes, as a child, I spent many happy afternoon down there. And what I said at the end of it was I wasn't saying that we were going to give them money in any way, shape or form, because obviously if we could, I would do. But as we've just been talking about budgets and things, it's not on. But what we can do, we can give them the things what go around that. We can give them the advice, we can show them where, who to go to, what to do, and things like that. And you know, and that's what I was trying to get over. He actually cut me short in the interview, and he wouldn't let me go any further than what I said. So obviously it was a little bit obstructive of what he tried to do right at the end. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. It's just an observation about Councillor Briggs's comment on the East Lancashire University Enterprise Zone. I'm not sure that his answer went fully enough into what an actual enterprise zone is, in that it provides incentives for businesses, it provides changes in the governance arrangements for businesses, and it's... I'm just reading off the wonderful things these when you can get them to work. They provide tax breaks and government support, so they do a bit more than just, you know, thank you for, you know, bringing business into the town. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. PE1, page 150, educational attainment. First of all, I'd like to congratulate all the students this year on gaining the grades that they achieved. I think we all agree within this council chamber, Burnley has a hell of a long way to go to get to where we want it to be, where it needs to be, that we're giving our young people the best start in life. What I was interested with, and I've conjured with this over a few years, in terms of how you try and put a positive spin on the education results, and you found another way this year, which was saying that the most improved amongst Lancashire districts, which, to be perfectly frank, from what I remember of last year's results, wouldn't have been very difficult, to be honest. Having said that, I welcome the direction of travel, but I look forward to seeing where the actual scores actually are in terms of relation to the other boroughs, and if we are making some headway in actually closing the gap between ourselves and them. The other two things I'd just like to highlight on the same page are Children's University and Primary and Secondary Engineer, and I just want to endorse everything that you've said there. I think they've been fantastic projects over the last number of years. We've had some real financial problems over the last few years, but we did find some money to actually put into each of those, and hopefully the children that have took part in those have had a good start for them to kick on for really vibrant and prosperous futures. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. It's page 150, and it's educational attainment. But again, it's on the Thomas Whitton High School, and I'm very glad to hear from the opposition and obviously from the leader that we are going to be putting our consultation in as Burnley Council. Personally, I'll be doing the same for being a councillor, and personally, because I've had a niece that's just come through the school. I've got a niece, great niece, going to go through the school this time, supposedly. But we do have to also look at the financial issues and the issues that this school has and why it is where it is. A lot of us are in positions in schools, governance, etc., etc., where we could influence in a way how those education needs are then met and how they go on to other schools. And we need to look at why this school has been left where it is. From having a capacity of 600, now only has a capacity of 450, but he's at, I think, 125. If they got to the 450, they would still only be breaking even. We really do need to look at what we can do. One, to fill the school up. Obviously, there's no point having schools without children in them. And we do need expansion, so there should be a small gap. But how we then get those children into that school, it is a completely different type of education than going to the colleges and universities. I went to the Burnley College myself, and the smaller environment some people need with certain needs, which my family, the people that I've gone through there have, this is a prime example of something we should be trying to look to save. How we do that in these financial times is something we all need to look at and get the consultation forms in. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. PR5, page 151, we will support UCLAN's expansion, transforming Burnley into a university town. Just an observation on that, just to say that I was fortunate enough to graduate last week, I think it was last week. And can I just say, UCLAN, Burnley College, everybody that was involved in that, what a fantastic advert for the town. Absolutely fantastic. I had a fantastic day with my family, and everybody involved in that needs to be commended for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, I'll try and be brief. I just wanted to pick up on two observations. First is in relation to Councillor Pate's comments about the sixth form. I just want to echo everything that she said in relation to having the sixth form option. I was fortunate enough to go to a sixth form for my education, and there are really key differences between sixth forms and colleges. For example, I was able to get involved in the charity commission at the school and arrange an entire school walk for muscular dystrophy. That's something you can't do with youngsters in a college because there are no youngsters around. So there are key differences, and it would be good to highlight those. So thank you for raising that. The second thing is in relation to the comments and response about the Empire Theatre. I just want to say that it's a building that we have in the town that we really should be proud of, and I really, really welcome the comments that we will do everything we can to support it, whether that's financial or not. And just to give a note of thanks to the people who are running Burnley Empire Theatre Trust, they're all volunteers. They've managed to change history already. Houdini actually performed in Burnley Empire Theatre, and that had been lost, and they managed to dig that out and get that history record corrected. So let's really support these important buildings in our town. Thanks.
PF4, it's over onto page 155, and I am going to come to the governance arrangements. I was interested when, going back to the strategic plan that we discussed earlier, that there's a brand new strategic objective in there that says we will set up cross-party working groups to investigate issues that matter to everyone in our borough. Quite a simple question, really. Can I ask how many telephone calls or how many times she's been stopped on the street to, say, set up a working group to basically discuss governance arrangements and committee structures? Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. In relation to the governance plan and Councillor Townsend's question, nobody's asked me about setting up a working group because that's not the sort of conversations I tend to have with residents when I'm talking to them. Quite a lot of them have said about the fact that so many councillors get paid an allowance and don't actually seem to do a lot for it. And I think in a way that's probably the same thing, isn't it? So I'll take that as my answer. In relation to Councillor Pate's question, I'm just trying to find which section of it is it, Councillor Pate? It's, I know it's PF1, and we have had problems. Second paragraph. We've had problems with it. And we need to install. I don't know the exact date of when we will be installing a new conductor. I assume it will be in line with the repairs to the roof, but I will happily make sure that you receive an answer to that.
Thank you, Matt. It's just a quick observation about the question and response about the governance review and committee structures. I just also wanted to say that, you know, quite often I hear from residents who feel that the council is closed-minded and things that happen behind closed doors, and really that's a symptom of not being open, democratic and transparent, and therefore having a governance review is an important thing to do.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. It's page 159, PL4, Muslim burials. Firstly, I'd like to thank the member for the support for securing a site for Muslim burial. And I'd like to thank the officers that have been very supportive. I've been very close to this and have been working closely with the local community as there was very limited places. The question is, can executive member assure me that he will work with the officers to ensure that we do have a plan ahead, so when this place space runs out, that we're not meeting an emergency to try to find. So that's one bit. And the second bit is to look at how we compare with the neighbouring authorities in terms of the burial costs. Thank you.
Everything more or less seems to be in hand with the burial situ- burial grounds. So any other, there's no seem to be any issues from the Christian or the non-Christian communities and that. And the area is properly marked, going to be properly marked out. So everything should be fine with the Muslim community and all other communities.
Yeah, sorry, the second part is the how we compare in terms of the cost with our neighbouring authorities. Are we on similar, or if we're higher, then is there anything that council can consider to bring in line?
Quite honestly, I don't know the answer to that, but I'll have to get have a word with the officers and then come back to you.
Thank you. Just bear with me a second. So my first, I've got two questions, please, but it's covering up. My question's actually covering it up. So it's PL3 on page 157. It's just to pass comment on the changing places. I'm really pleased to see this in because it was something that I got involved in quite a while back, along with a now very good friend of mine, Zach Kerr from Hindburn, who was disappointed that when he came to Burnley, he didn't have anywhere to get changed. And we used some of the money from last year to repurpose a room within St. Peter's Centre. And it's made a big difference to those visitors to that centre and to anybody else that comes into the town. So I'm very pleased to see that you've continued that style. And I would also like to ask, as a follow-on from that, will there be any more improvements to come, large-scale ones, not just the small facilities grants that are going out to homes, but anything big for the town? Because obviously the improvements to Haddon House are great, but there are people who are struggling to get respite, particularly those that don't have a learning disability but do have a physical disability. They want to be in places that are stimulating, not in with the old folk in the old people's homes, because that's where they've got a hoist. And just to go to the second point about electric cars, which is under PL4. I can't resist it. PL4, page 159. I'm very, very pleased to see this, of course, electric car driver and Renault driver. So I'm really pleased. This is my dream, is to get one of these Renault vans myself. But I would just ask, are we putting in some additional risk assessments for these staff, having noted that Councillor Campbell saw one of the staff come off his bike on the street and it's, you know, been in an accident on the bike. I just think, have we definitely got some training in for these staff on the bikes? Because it feels like the more we bring out, obviously, the more risk there's going to be that somebody gets hurt, and it does bother me a little bit. Thank you.
I would say on the disabled side, there's disabled grants have been approved, helping accessible in homes. There's 59 actually completed at the moment, and there's positive steps assisting to the most in those in need. With the electric bikes, I'll have to come back to you on that one with the risk assessment. I'll have to have a word with the officers.
You'll have to forgive me, I'm not sure whether it's an observation or a question, but I just wanted to, PL3, page 157, we will work with partners to improve quality and choice in the borough's housing stock. I just want to bring it to the attention of this chamber that one of the partners that we work with is Calico, and in my ward, it's fantastic to see all the investment that Calico puts in the building new homes and the development of the town. But I have a serious concern around the social housing element of what Calico is doing. In my ward, there is some social housing, and I've got serious concerns about the quality of that housing, and also in terms of how Calico are responding and treating some of their residents. And what I would call on, and on the exec member on this, is to work alongside the ward councillors to try and have this resolved, because at one level you've got the Calico, which are a fantastic partner and developing the town and pushing us forward, but they are forgetting their social housing and the tenants who are at the bottom, and I don't think that is fair. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Page 159, PL4. It's just to bring up Muslim burials again. I don't think enough of a song and dance has been made about this, so I'd just like to do that, really. I think originally the burial plot wasn't allocated in the area that it is, and it took a lot of hard work from certain councillors in this chamber. I'd like to mention them: Councillor Ishtiaq Mohammed, Councillor Afrasiab Anwar, Councillor Arif Khan, and many others. And they did a lot of work with the Muslim community and officers, and I'd like to congratulate this council and Councillor Emo on recognising that the Muslim burial plot is where it should be, and long may it continue. It is quite a historical thing that's happened, so I just wanted to make a bit of a song and dance about that. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I think it's PL2 156, basically relating to what Councillor Anwar said there about Calico. Again, this week, I've had the same sort of thing, at least two reports of people in social housing or with particular issues with Calico. And I think the scrutiny chairman said there, it's on the list of one of the things we're going to scrutinise this year, is our involvement with not just Calico, but any of the agencies, because
the concerns you could hear all around the chamber, the concerns that some of our members have had with Calicut, and hopefully this will then get to the bottom of it. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Just to quickly observe, I went to the mechanics on Sunday, so under PE2, page 159, we had an event at the mechanics on Sunday, which was the world's first Nasheed choir. So it's very technical, but that was a packed out room. There was not a seat in that theatre, and it was amazing seeing those kids. The difference is that Nasheed does not sing in harmony, and these kids were singing in harmony, along with Husnain Hanif. He's a good friend of mine from Radio Lancashire, from Pendle. We met on our day out. It was amazing to see them, and long may that sort of event continue. Lots and lots of proud parents. Wonderful to see.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. It's page 156. Very briefly, could I agree with Councillor Amwar about the properties that some of Calico tenants have to live in? As a simple example, I have a couple of ladies who live in my ward who live in Calico bungalows, and they've complained about the damp, and they're getting short shrift off Calico, what they were until I went to see Calico. One lady had every week to put a bed mattress against the radiator in her bedroom to dry the mattress so that she could sleep in it the following week. Now, in the years that we're living in now, for an elderly lady to have to lift her mattress off a bed and put it against a radiator to dry it, along with the bedding that goes with it, I think is absolutely outrageous. When I brought this to the Calico's attention, they said, well, it's condensation. You just need to go and look at the place and realise it's not condensation. I'm not a builder, but it certainly isn't condensation. Thankfully, we managed to get an inspector to go and look at it, and I will be happy to report back to the next council meeting that this lady's problems, along with a couple more, have been resolved. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
I so move, Madam Mayor.
Thank you. It is PL1, page 160. Just to say, I'm really pleased to see the introduction of collections for pots, tubs and trays. I'm sure you're all sick of hearing about me every council meeting, me saying, why don't we collect pots, tubs and trays? And now we do. So it's a good move. Lancashire County Council have announced that that'll be for every home. But thanks also to Councillor Townley, who I'm assuming had a hand in that too. Thank you.
Sorry, yeah, just to re-emphasise the point that Councillor Pate has made, and I absolutely love the new bins that we've got, because it's got me recycling, my three-year-old. Unfortunately for me, what she's doing...
What a good idea!
What she's doing...
You have to keep them.
But she's actually really enthusiastic about it. But so the point I'm trying to make is that it's really, really good, because from a young age she's learning about recycling. But just again an observation, and I'd like to thank the exec member on this point, is that with regards to when the bins have been getting delivered, I think there might have been a bit of a fall off in terms of collections in some of the areas, and particularly in our ward. But I do... I thank the exec member for responding to that, and a meeting has been set up to resolve that. So thank you.
Sorry.
Yeah, just again, Councillor Townley, you get in with a good report in action with Park as well. Everybody seems to be happy with these new bins. You put a lot of good effort in. Well done.
Yes, please, Madam Mayor. Thank you all. I'm obviously just facing up a very small team who have worked incredibly hard over a number of years, and it's all now coming together. There is going to be a slight fall off occasionally with other collections while this is rolled out. 17,000 homes have been supplied with bins. As I say, we are having a rolling review, so we do appreciate any and all comments that come in all shapes, sizes, and whether you like them or not. So I would like to say, I would just really like to thank the street scene staff. They are led by an exceptional officer, and the morale is high. I think that's probably about it.
Yes, I'm delighted to move my report, and if I could just make a couple of comments. One being on the, I went to the event where Councillor Omar received his cap and gown, and it was an absolutely superb event, and I didn't realise that some of the students that went to the college and got these awards were nearly as old as me, so I did. Not including Councillor Omar. So it's really good to see, it was really good to see not only 18, 19, 20, 22 or 23 year old, and Councillor Omar's age, there were some people there who were later in life.
More mature.
Secondly, I went to see another event from Themis at the college for the young apprentices getting their awards. That equally was a fantastic event, showing the talent that we have in this town, and basically they're all training to be engineers of the future, which was, again, was fantastic. I only hope that Brexit doesn't ruin their future prospects. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I guess it's under PR3 on page 164. Bear with me 30 seconds while I find the other bit. Right. I'd refer to the Burnley Enforcement Plan 2015, in particular the item 12 on advertisements, which says it is an offence under the Town and Country Planning Act to display an advertisement without express consent. If officers consider that an application to the advertisement would probably be granted, then a retrospective application will be requested. Where the advertisement causes serious harm to amenity or public safety, a request will be made for its removal within a specific period. At the bottom of Manchester Road is what can only be described as an advert for a petty reel. It's been up now nearly 2 months. It's on scaffolding. There has been no work done to the building or the outside of that building in the 2 months. So in my opinion, it is purely an advertisement. It completely compromises the conservation area, which we're trying to protect. And my question to the member is, can you give us an up-to-date thing? Do the council consider it probably to be getting a retrospective application granted? Or when will we take some action as related to the enforcement plan?
I'm not 100% sure, Madam Mayor, but I'm happy to answer, Councillor. I have looked into this because I think that advertising hoarding is hideous. It's taking total advantage of the generosity of the council for allowing them to do it without planning permission. I have spoken to the head of planning, and he's looking into the possibility of getting the company to put in for planning permission. I think it looks hideous on the area where it is. It's in a very attractive area of Burnley, and I hope that we can get them to apply for planning, and I will let Councillor Baker know as soon as I find out whether they've applied for planning and what we're going to do about enforcing it.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This is in relation to PR3 on page 164 and Pioneer Place. I'm getting old now, so my memory is not what it was. But I seem to remember when this first came up for discussion before the council initially. I think it was yourself, Councillor Bertrissel, that asked if all the conditions had to be in place before it went ahead. And I think you were told that it would. Can I therefore take it that the site on Manchester Road has got a tenant or a prospective tenant in place, which was meant to be a supermarket, I think. And would you know further if the council is going to take over the running of the pub and whether it expects that's on the current site of Real Cinema, and whether you expect to get the full £100,000 a year rent from that pub that it currently attracts once the cinema, which gives it its captive audience, has moved.
At this moment in time, the only documents signed are for Real Cinema to take the lease up on the proposed site on Pioneer Place. Nothing, and I can assure you, nothing while I'm in this position, nothing will move or be signed off as a complete thing until a deal is done with a potential leaseholder of the present Real Cinema. As at this moment in time, negotiations are going on. Nothing has been decided. No deals have been done. So you can be assured that the only thing that's been signed is a potential lease agreement with the Real Cinema. Once everything is in place, and I agree with it, I did ask that question, once all the ducks are in a line, then everything will be signed. But if there's one duck not there, it won't happen. So the duck will be dead, yes.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. This is PR3, page 164. Can the executive member clarify and explain what strategic projects they've got in place for Paddington Centre?
Thank you. PR4, page 164. Just to ask the executive member if, when he's looking at infrastructure within the town centre, if he could give some consideration to the poor connectivity on the telephony so both mobile and the green box system around the bottom of the bus station area where Calico is based. It turns out that there's quite poor telephone system around there, which I'm assuming will impact on businesses that want to move into any properties in that area. I mean, Hall Street is pretty much vacant. And I am wondering whether that's got anything to do with it. But obviously, that's for a larger piece of work. But I would urge the member to try and do what he can to investigate that as an issue. Thank you.
I think. Wait, is there any more? I'll wait. Is there some more?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I've got two questions. The first question is on the page 164, PR3, Lower St James's Street. And if colleagues can look at the paragraph where he's putting in his report, saying basically how delighted he is that Burnley's been selected as one of 69 towns, and I think we can all agree with that, Madam Mayor. He then talks about and gives some detail about the scheme itself. And interestingly, it points out to the public realm work which is going to take place around there, and he talks about how important that public realm work is and is of high quality. And what I'd like this council to do is contrast those remarks, what's in the report, to the one he made when the previous administration, along with its partners, the county council, refurbished and restored the public realm in Burnley town centre. You said, and I quote, "They are going to spend the money on paving stones for the town centre. You couldn't make it up, could you? They are a joke." So my question to the exec member is, when did you decide that public realm really does matter and that it plays a key part in any regeneration? Thank you. My apologies, Madam Mayor. The second question, I should have said that. That's on page 164/165. And again, he's telling us how delighted he is, and I think we're all delighted about that, about the Rosegrove Junction and the benefits, what the improvements of this junction will bring to residents and car drivers regarding journey times and air quality. I think, though, Mr. Mayor, and I'll stand corrected on this, he's missed an important part out on this. and if I've got this wrong, I will apologise to Councillor Bird Whistles. Should he not have also put in there that the work on that junction is also going to enable the extension of Network 65 and Burnley Bridge? Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Telephone, Joe, I don't know. I didn't know there was a problem with the telephones down by the bus station, but I will ask a question about that and let you know. Lower St James Street, yes, I'm delighted that Councillor Harbour asked me that. I fully expected him to ask me that. He will note on the thing that a lot of the money is going to focus on Lower St, bringing empty buildings back into use. So a lot of money will be bringing a lot of the empty buildings that spoil that area back into use. Okay, they'll have to put do the road as well, but the roads part of it is not the full amount. I don't know what percentage is, but it's certainly less than 50% of the use to bring the buildings back into use, and that will promote people to come in and use those buildings rather than leave them empty and somewhat very tired situation. Again, regarding the Rosegrove Junction, well, I don't know how often Councillor Harbour goes through the Rosegrove Junction. I go through it most days. The junction is probably the most dangerous junction in Burnley, which this development will certainly help in improving road safety there. It will certainly stop the traffic queuing back up Rossendale Road, which queued back in the morning, back up to the garage and beyond. That will assist the flow of traffic from there. And it will certainly assist the flow of traffic coming from Rosegrove up to the lights. They will be able to turn left safely, because the old toilets that are there are being demolished and the road will be taken around there. So I don't know where he got the idea that this to promote the industrial estate up in Apton. I have no idea how it links to that. It links to traffic safety, to the increased movement of traffic, improving the movement of traffic off Rossendale Road from coming up from Ghana, and certainly make the road a lot safer. There are many, many accidents at that junction with cars going straight through off Rossendale Road and cars cutting across from the road that comes up from Ghana to turn right. That hopefully will be resolved. So if Councillor Harbour is not particularly interested in traffic safety, then he'll not be interested in my response. But that is what I view it as being an important feature to be done at that junction. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Yeah, to be fair, Councillor Birchwistle didn't answer the question from Councillor Shabana Khan at all. And in fact, just to make an observation before I ask my question, the money for the Rossendale Road improvements would not have come to Lancashire County Council if it had not been tied up to the extension to Network 65 and Burnley Bridge. My question is really a matter of omission. I'm not sure whether it comes under PR2 on 163 or PR3, because it relates to the market, Burnley Market. No mention's been made by Councillor Birtwistle in any of his reports so far about the future of Burnley Market. And I saw in the press on Monday that after 800 years, Rochdale Market has ceased trading because it is no longer financially viable, and the council has decided that ultimately we can't use public money to subsidise the market indefinitely when it is losing money month after month. Can the executive member confirm that the planned review of Burnley Market, which has been planned for quite a number of months, if not years now, is underway, and that the executive will take a similar pragmatic approach to Burnley Market's future as Rochdale took? Thank you. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Well, can I assure Councillor Graham that Council Leader, Councillor Briggs and Councillor Sumner, we spend a lot of time in the market. We go in at least two or three times a week, and we spend money in there drinking tea, coffee, and talking to the residents, and moreover talking to the tenants of the market hall. And we've had a talk with them, we've had a meeting with them, and asked them basically what would they like, and basically they want more footfall. So we are presently working on a scheme to bring into the market hall what was the outside market that you closed down, that you shut off the footfall to the outside market by knocking the bridge down. So we're now looking at bringing some of the outside market back into the inside market, and having a proper five-day market with the market hall as full as we can get it. That is our proposal. Regarding the closure of Rochdale Market, I'm pleased to say that as soon as we heard of the closure of Rochdale Market, the market hall manager hot-footed it to Rochdale and spoke to a number of tenants in Rochdale Market and invited them to come and see what a possibly future vibrant market hall we have in Burnley, with a view to them coming to join us in Burnley. So I'm delighted that you've asked that question. I'm delighted that I'm sure that you spent plenty of time in the market hall like we do every week, and you also spoke to the residents, to the tenants, and know what is going on there. But I'm pleased to say we are looking at the proposal now. We've got the proposal done. We're getting the final prices together. We're getting the drawings done for how it will be laid out. And our markets manager, who is absolutely excellent, went over to Rochdale with some leaflets to come and bring your wares to Burnley, and we'll be delighted to see them and possibly buy them. Thank you very much, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. It's regarding the two questions I asked and the question my colleague asked about Paddington and Councillor Birtwistle's response to it. What was disappointing, Madam Mayor, he always misrepresents people to Councillor Birtwistle. There are many colleagues in this chamber tonight who heard me congratulate the executive member and the council, saying that we all agreed on the improvements to Lower St James Street. We're all delighted about that. I also said about the junction at Rosegrove that I was delighted that income was coming in for that, and it would make it safer. What I actually said to him was, and in the question was, but it's more than that. And a colleague of mine have just confirmed what it's all about. It is about, in my opinion, enabling the extension of Network 65 and Burnley Bridge. I also drew a comparison of what he said about public realm work now that he's the exec member, and what he thinks about public realm work now and how important it is to how we rubbish this administration when we regenerated the town centre with high quality public realm work. That's all I was asking, Madam Mayor. But this is the one what gets me, this is the important one. This is the one where a man who aspires to be the town's next MP, when we're talking about Paddington. My colleague asked him regarding Paddington about what are the strategic objectives, and all he could come up with was one. Now, anybody who represents Paddington or anybody who knows Padiham know for a fact there is far more than one strategic objective for Padiham. There's a townscape heritage work, a 1.4 million from the heritage, 0.6 million through private enterprise and through this council match funding. There's the public realm work, what's going on, 1.9 million, which is going to run from the roundabout at Moor Lane right through to the roundabout at Tesco's. Major improvement on the street signal on Burnley Road, using high quality materials, wide enough footways, introduction of crossing points, the creation of focal points, and the decluttering of street scene. Heard nothing about this from the exec member who's responsible for it. Then we look at the flood defences, which again is never mentioned, but it's a strategic objective for this council. As I understand, the scheme is going to be something like £6 million to introduce. Now, to be fair to Councillor Burswittle, he acknowledged that the last administration, along with the council's officers, brought funding in to secure these projects. Working out, you know, and we're working there with our partners from the Environment Agency. The Baxi site, a redundant site for many, many years, an eyesore. Now working with Homes England to create an aspirational high quality development on this brownfield site. Nothing mentioned. All he could mention were two shops. If that's the quality of the exec member who's supposed to be producing results for this town, then God help us if he actually wants to be the MP as well. Thank you, Madam Mayor.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I'm afraid my esteemed colleague over there seems to have stolen some of my thunder. The flood improvements indeed were have been secured, the money for that, but I have to say only through, at the end of the day, intervention of the Conservative member at County Council after we came up against a certain authority which was very much against us being able to fund the whole of the need, which is somewhat more than you suggested financially. As far as the Rosegrove Junction is concerned, welcome those, though, although the work is, the fact remains that getting vehicles on and off the motorway and over that motorway bridge is actually the problem to the extension. And that is a problem that I don't think we will overcome.
Thank you. It was on PR2, 163, on skills and apprenticeships. Having previously sat on scrutinies where we've been given reports around the dropout rates on apprenticeships, and of course we're all mindful of Sir Thomas Whittam as well, I'm looking at this and thinking I've not seen anything in quite some time around our apprenticeship rates, and obviously I'm thinking that it might come up somewhere on a report or maybe to scrutiny, and I'll be looking forward to seeing that when it does come. Thank you.
Well, yes, of course, and I'm delighted that Councillor Harbour has informed me what's going on. I think it might have been easier if he spoke to his colleague, Councillor Saban, who obviously has more. I'm speaking, sit down. Sit down. I mean, Councillor Arbour is not happy to speak to his colleague and wants that.
Sorry to interrupt, Councillor Birkinsell. Just as a procedural point, before the meeting automatically ceases, can we just suspend standing orders for, say, 15 minutes? Can we have a mover and a second?
5 minutes.
5 minutes.
No.
Well, the meeting's ended then. We need to go home. Go on. Somebody move and second
it. That is that one. Regarding the apprenticeship, I don't have those figures. And I'm happy to ensure that we get those figures at the next meeting.
And I think I answered everything else that's been on.
None have been received, Madam Mayor.